Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
Hi, and I'm Ed Hathaway. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how it works. There's teachers from Dial Teacher standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now, remember, you can also send your comments at our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your comments.
All right, now we'll get to our science challenge in just a moment, but first we'd like to let our viewers know that a little later in the show, Tim Cawley will be here from the Rochester Museum and Science Center to show us some fun science experiments.
All right, now let's get to our science challenge. We'll do a little more science. A science night, Ed.
It is a science
night.
All right. I'll nod my head, watch you guys go at it. That'll be great.
All right, I got a balance here.
So I see
okay?
that.
And so I've got just an empty paper bag, and I'm going to get the mass of that.
All right.
And it's 3.5 grams.
All right, I'm going to write that down for you.
All right. And I also have a balloon, and I'm going to get the mass of that.
Okay.
And our balloon is 2.8 grams.
Got it.
Okay?
All right.
All right. Now I'm just going to open my bag up and let it fill with air here.
All right.
And I'm going to do the same with my balloon. I'm going to blow that up. So let me fold this over so we can keep the air in it. So we got a little bag of air.
There you go.
Don't want our air escaping.
Big bag of air. So you're doing the same thing here.
All right, so I'll blow our balloon up. Maybe a little more.
Okay.
Don't want it to pop.
All right.
All right, now I'll tie the balloon. All right. All right, so our bag fell apart on us here. Let me open it up again.
All right, get more air in there.
The bag was... There we go. There we go. And this was, you said...
The bag was 3.5 grams.
All right. So let's put that on our balance and see what it is now. It's still 3.5 grams.
Still 3.5. Okay. Didn't change.
All right. Let's try our balloon. I may have to balance this a little bit to keep it from falling off.
That is more.
It is more when it stops.
All right.
Let's say about 3.1, Ed, because it keeps going. 3.1.
Okay, I'm writing down 3.1.
But
that's interesting that one went up.
It is more, right?
Even though they both had air in them.
Yeah, and you know it. Why? It doesn't seem like it's heavier. It falls slower, doesn't it?
That's going to lead to a good question, I'm sure.
I like your idea. So, yeah, that will be our question. So our question tonight is, why did the balloon's mass increase when I blew it up, but the bags remained the same when we filled it with air?
It's a good science challenge, Mr. Z. Again, the science challenge tonight is, why did the balloon's mass increase, but the bags remain the same? Now, if you think you can solve this science challenge, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904. Or you can just answer on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Remember, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
All right. Great question for you.
And I think we have a great question for you now.
I think we do. Let's see who it is. Hello? Gabriella? Gabriella, we're talking to you. Are you there?
Hello?
I think they're having a conversation. I hope we didn't lose her.
Hello,
Gabriella?
Gabriella, we're talking to you.
Hello?
Hi, Gabriella. You might want to turn off your TV.
And just listen up.
And listen to us, okay, Gabriella?
Turn down your TV. Yeah.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to go to the board here, Mr. Z.
All right.
All right, Gabriella.
Hi.
Thank you for calling. That's great. And we hear you have a question about a Jimmy's gift store. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, great. And you gave us some information, but I want to make sure I have it right. Okay, Gabriella? So help me out. How much does one basket of fruit cost at Jimmy's store? Was it $26?
It says if each basket sells for $26, how much money did Jimmy earn from the gift baskets sold?
Okay, now these are fruit baskets. Okay, I think you had some more information too, Gabriella. How many pieces of fruit go into each basket? Do you see that anywhere? I think it was 13. Does that sound right?
Oh, it says number per basket for fruits is 13. Yes.
Good. And then finally, that you were also told that this guy, Jimmy, had 3,315 pieces of fruit. Okay? So let's start to solve this, Gabriella. What we can do here is we want to figure out, taking this 13 and the 3,315, how many baskets he can make. So what we're going to do, what do you think we should do here? Should we add, subtract, multiply, divide? You got any idea here, Gabriella? Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of a hint. We are going to divide 13 into 3,315, okay, Gabriella? This will tell us how many baskets he did. Can you help me? 13 won't go into 3, but 13 will go into 33 about how many times do you think, Gabriella? We didn't lose her. Well, we're going to try 2, Gabriella. Gabriella, if you're there, what's 2 times 3? Well, we may have lost her. So, Gabriella, I hope you're watching. We'll go through this division. 13 will go into 33 twice. So we'll subtract. We'll bring down a 7 here and bring down a 1. How many times 13 will go into 71? I'm going to try 6. Let's see, 18. Oh, there you are. 78, that's too much, Gabriella. So we're going to try 5. 15 carry our 1 gives us 65.
Okay.
Oh, good. And I already know that 13 goes into 65 5 times. So, Gabriel, 255 is how many baskets Jimmy can make. Now, Gabriella, how much does each basket cost again? You remember? $26, right?
Yes. Yeah. $26.
So we are going to multiply 255 by 26. So if we multiply that, we'll get 30, a 3, carry, let's see, 33, carry another 3, 12, 15. Did I do that right, Gabriel? I think so.
Yeah,
I think I did. All right, I'm going to put down a 0. Going to multiply again. I'll get 10, carry a 1 this time. I'll get a 1 here, carry another 1, and a 5. So we get 0, 3, 6, 6. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
If we did all that math correct. So that means Jimmy is making, of course, he had to pay for the baskets and the fruit and transportation, but he's making $6,630. It's a lot of money, isn't it, Gabriella?
Wow, yeah.
Yeah, that was a great question. Thank you for calling. Bye-bye.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Yeah.
All right, now we'll get back to the question in just a moment, but first we'd like to welcome Tim from the Rochester Museum and Science Great Center to the show. Yes. Tim, what do you got for us, man?
Well, we've got a few experiments for you right here. The first one we're going to do is with copper plating, and this one you can do at home. It's pretty cool, easy little experiment. What you want to do is find a bunch of pennies. Now, not just any pennies. These pennies have to be from 1981 or earlier. They have to be older pennies because the newer pennies are made of zinc and the older pennies are made more of copper. So we've got these copper pennies. What you want to do also is you take the copper pennies, you take some fine steel wool, and you're going to turn around and shine them up. The reason why is you want to take all the dirt off of them. Your pennies are probably pretty dirty from the emollients on your hands and lotions and skin and everything else.
Get them nice and
so
clean.
We get them all nice and clean. I've taken the liberty to get a bunch of them clean already. And turn around. We're going to take a little bit of vinegar. All right. Let me pour it in here, see if I can get it right. That's probably good enough.
Exactly that much.
There, it's close enough for government work. And we're going to pour some salt inside here. And this is the solution we're going to take. We'll take a couple of nails. Once again, we'll shine these up. We'll spin that in. We'll mix that up. And right now, we're going to take the pennies, and we're going to put the pennies inside the solution. What's going to happen is the pennies will turn around. The copper is very soft metal, and it's going to turn around and start to break down. And when it does, the copper is going to be attracted to the steel nail, and it'll go right to that. We'll set that over to the side because we've got a lot to do. Inside here, we've got a little neodymium magnet or a rare earth magnet. And inside of our little jar, we've got some iron filings and a matrix, which is just a solution that's around it that's mineral oil. And what we're going to do is this is the Elvis magnet.
You're talking about this earlier.
At the end, we'll take a look at this. What it's going to be, really super strong neodymium magnet. You can put it inside, and when you do, it starts to collect the iron filings. And when it does, you can see, you hear about a magnetic field, and you can see them because magnets stick to iron or to metal, but here you can see it in 3D. You can actually see as it goes along, and as it starts to weaken out, it sets down to the end. So there's your magnets.
It does look a little bit like Elvis's.
Well, it'll look better at the end. We'll hook it up in the end, because right now, because we've got to go to my next part, we were working with copper. And as long as we're working with copper, I forgot to mention that copper, once again, soft a little metal, and we've got some copper tubing. What the cool part about copper tubing is it's very soft, but when it's soft, you can turn around and you can bend it very easily. So it bends down. But what it also has is what's known as work hardening. When you look at copper, it's all connected together. As you start to bend it, the stress starts to come through and it starts to get little ripples in it. Those ripples interlock. Now, all of this, really super easy to bend, but now it doesn't bend back because all those ripples have connected together and it's locked together. So we turn around. That's a pretty cool aspect. Oh, I almost forgot. We'll take a look at, right now, we've got a little aluminum tube. And we have another neodymium magnet. Now, you notice I keep the neodymium magnet inside of the tennis ball. And that's because when you really start to look at it, it'll even catch. If you catch your fingers in between a couple of neodymium magnets, it's going to sting.
You got a little blister. Yeah.
And what we're going to do is take this out.
Or the break.
And we take it, and you put it against the aluminum. You'll see that it doesn't, it's not magnetic. But the cool part about it is, if we hold it right here, drop it, it drops pretty fast.
It drops normal,
Drops really quick. But there's a gentleman named Lenz. His law turns around, and with that, the idea is, if we put it inside of the tube.
Oh, look how long it took for that to
drop. It takes a little while. Now, it does that, and it's a pretty cool reason why. Because magnets have two poles. South and north, or positive and negative. And by Lenz's law, when you take a magnet and you put it into a conducting tube, which is basically a copper tube or this metal tube, this aluminum tube, as it goes through, it starts to create a magnetic field. And that magnetic field turns around, it starts to build around the magnet. And if you take a magnet and you put south and a south together, what happens?
I don't know.
They push apart. They repel. Okay. Mm-hmm. But a south and a north, opposites attract, pull right together.
Oh, so it's kind of force balance. Well,
actually,
in
that
there.
Moving is generating electric current. Electric current is then generating the magnetic the field that's opposing.
Exactly. And so, inside
and
all the way around
the delay it. For it to fall,
it actually through. Causes a little what's known as resistance. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't fall through quite as quickly.
Oh, that one was really long.
Yeah. So, so it's really pretty cool. Pretty neat little demo that you can do. And we'll turn around. We'll look. Mm-hmm. This guy right here, this might take you a little bit of time.
Right.
I see. Might be 15 minutes, half hour, maybe an hour. Depends on it. I'd use these the other day, and I put them inside. What you really want to do is try to get the pennies to touch them. That way the copper jumps across from one to the other. It doesn't do it so quickly, but it's still a pretty neat demo. And the magnet, once again, the neodymium, you want to put it inside of a plastic container to hold it, because if you put it through glass, you take a chance on actually breaking the breaking the glass, because that magnet is so strong. But if you put it in that mineral oil inside of something like a mason jar like we have it, you can turn around, seal it, you can have it for years to work like this. Mm-hmm. And actually you turn and you take a look. Once again, we've got a lot of that magnet. You can see the magnetic field. Now, the neodymium magnet that's in there is a trapezoidal shape, which means that it's going to have an angle to it. Mm. And when we do, what we do is, if you excuse me over here, because this is where it gets a little bit messy, we'll turn around, and let's see if we can get a little bit of Elvis
on looking,
this. There we go.
That's great.
Well, maybe it's Elvis on a bad hair day.
All right, right on a bad day.
Not exactly Elvis. This is Elvis after a show in Vegas. You know, it's a tough kind of a gig for him. But you can see all the iron filings. They all kind of make that little Elvis look.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's really pretty cool. Yeah. And actually, working with magnets and this stuff comes out pretty nice, easy to do at home. As I said. Now, this doesn't happen really quick, the copper plating, but you have to cut a little bit of slack, because we're not flying the...
Well, you can show here, Tim, what the nails look like before and then after, too.
And then after.
Yeah. Now you can really see the distinct difference.
All right. The chemistry students out there.
Get the camera in there,
Your table J explains that one.
Exactly. And it's all has to do with... physics, chemistry, it's all pretty cool. It's all stuff you can do at home. Pretty simple, easy to do. But once again, if you're playing with the neodymium magnets, be really careful with them. Because I actually today got a couple of them stuck together. Thankfully, my finger got in the way, so I could take them apart easy.
All right, well, we'd like to thank Tim for coming
tonight.
And
appreciate you coming on.
And thank you very much. Appreciate you being here.
Stay right back. We'll be here in a second.
Having trouble remembering the number of days in each month? Think of this saying. 30 days half September, April, June, and November. All the rest have 31, excepting February alone, which hath but 28 and fine, till leap year gives it 29.
And we're going to have those guys back again next month with some more experiences. So we got that to look forward to.
All right. We're always pleased to see the Rochester Museum and Science Center. That was
all right.
Great.
Jasmine, are you there?
Yeah.
Hi. I understand you have a math question for us, right?
Yes.
All right. Let me go to the board. And Jasmine, if I understood the question correctly, Erica's throwing a party, right? And she's going to buy 4 cans of soda for every 2 people?
Yes.
And then Jim's throwing a party, and he's going to buy 6 cans for every 4 people, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. But what they sent us, they said that who's going to have more soda. So is there more information we got to have, or are they asking who's having more per kid?
I don't think there's any more information. It's just saying, pretty much how much more soda.
How much is each person going to get? Is that what they're saying? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that makes sense. Now, what grade are you in, Jasmine?
Sixth grade.
So you know how to take a fraction and reduce it, right? Okay.
Yeah.
And you've worked that. So let's look at what we got here. We know, let's do Erica first. She's going to have four cans of soda for every two people, right?
Yes.
So I'm going to put the four cans in my numerator and the two people in my denominator. All right? So far, so good? All right?
Yes.
Let's reduce that. How much is one person going to get?
Well, one person is going to get four cans of soda.
Okay, so there's four cans for every two people, right?
Oh, I mean, one person is going to get two cans of soda.
Yeah, so if you go to Erica's party, everybody's going to get two cans of soda, right? So far, so good. So we know it's going to be two cans per person. Now, the other thing we could have done is divide, all right, four divided by two, because anytime we divide one thing by another, it's going to give us our unit rate, right? So we know what one person we get, right? So let's look at the other one. At Jim's party, he's buying more. He's buying six, but he's buying six for every four people, right? So far, so good. Can we reduce that?
Yeah, you can reduce it to three cans for two people.
Three cans for two people, okay? All right, and we could reduce that further, and we'd find it would be 1.5 per person, right? But notice here, we've got something right here and right here that have the same denominator, don't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, and we could compare fractions when they have the same denominator. So at Erica's party, there's going to be four cans for every two people, right? But at Jim's party, there's only going to be three cans for every two people. Whose party would you rather? Whose party would you rather go to?
Erica's.
You don't like soda that much, or you do like soda? Yes, Erica's got more, right? Yeah. Okay. So there's a couple different ways you could have worked that out. I'm not sure what you were doing. You could have done it by division. You could do it by fractions, where you could compare. Like denominator, this one was a little weird because it didn't go evenly. But we can see that at Erica's party, there's going to be more soda per person, right? All right, great job. All right. Well, thank you. Thanks for calling. You did a nice job.
This country attracts the second largest amount of tourists each year, behind France. The money brought in from this tourism really helps the country's economy. It is the eighth largest in the world. This country occupies most of the Iberian Peninsula, from the Pyrenees Mountains to the Strait of Gibraltar, connecting Europe and Africa. Spain, like many other countries in Europe, has a history filled with civil wars and social struggles. In the last 30 or so years, Spain has transformed itself into a modern nation, both in government and industry. Today, Spaniards are known for their love of life, which is seen through their passion for eating, singing music, and participating in religious festivals.
Well, Mr. Z, I think Seth, we have a winner in tonight's Science Challenge.
Hello, Seth.
Hi, Seth.
Hi.
How are you? Seth, what's going on here? How come this way had more mass, but the bag didn't?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Seth, and I...
Okay. Yeah, what's our answer, Seth?
It's the balloon.
Mm-hmm.
It got more air.
Yeah. Actually, the air in the balloon is under pressure, isn't it? Okay. And air does have mass, so the mass of the air in the balloon actually went up, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Caused the balloon to weigh more.
All right. Now the bag though has air in it, but it's the same amount of air that was above that bag when it was empty, right?
Yep.
Yeah. All right. So, yeah, because the balloon actually has air under pressure, we got more air packed in this balloon than if we had a similar size bag, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and air does have mass.
Okay.
Great job. What grade are you in, Seth?
Mm-hmm.
What grade are you in?
Third.
Oh, all right.
That's great.
Okay. Well, Seth, you did a great job. Are you studying these kind of things in school?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah, All right. I think you got some help, too, and that was good. It was good that they explained that to you. All right?
Nice job, Seth.
All right, Seth, you did a great job. Congratulations. But don't forget, now remember, every correct response will go into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. And if you're in enough points, you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
Now, that's all the time we have for tonight. We are going to say goodbye, but Dial a Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Now, on Monday, we'll be having a special Best of Homework Hotline episode. Dial a Teacher will be closed, and there will not be a daily challenge.
All right.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.